Sejam todos e todas bem-vindos à Feira do Livro 2024. A Feira do Livro é uma realização da Associação 451, da Maré Produções Culturais e do Ministério da Cultura por meio da Lei Federal de Incentivo à Cultura. Patrocínio, Grupo CCR, Itaú Unibanco e Rede, a Empresa de Pagamento de Itaú, TV Brasil e Rádio Nacional de São Paulo. Apoio, Instituto Ibirapitanga, Enjoei, Instituto Vera Cruz, Companhia das Letras, MOS, Livraria 2 Pontos, Instituto Camões e Embaixada da França no Brasil. Parceria de mídia, Folha de São Paulo e Revista Piauí. Parceiros, Bubu Café Restaurante, Meliá São Paulo e Genópolis, Associação Vagalume, Mais Diferenças, Ovo, Ecoar e Cartola Editora, Rede Lê, Clabin, Biblioteca Mário de Andrade, Secretaria Municipal de Cultura, Secretaria da Pessoa com Deficiência, Museu do Futebol, Secretaria de Cultura, Economia Criativa e Indústrias Criativas do Estado de São Paulo. Acompanhe a cobertura completa da Feira do Livro 2024 no site da revista 451. Acesse www.451.com.br e também nas nossas redes sociais, @Feira do Livro. Viva o livro brasileiro!
Olá, boa noite. Boa noite já, né? A todas, todos e todos aqui presentes. Queria agradecer a presença de todas as pessoas que vieram assistir a essa conversa e agradecer toda a equipe e produção da Feira do Livro e da Revista 451 pelo convite para comandar esse bate-papo. Nascido em 1962, em St. Louis, no estado do Missouri, Jabari Assim é jornalista, escritor, dramaturgo e professor, com uma vasta obra composta de livros de poesia, não-ficção, ficção e literatura infantil. Entre suas obras, em 2007, Jabari lançou The N-Word, Who Can Say It, Who Couldn't, and Why, uma pesquisa minuciosa que mostra seu empenho em desvendar as narrativas destrutivas incorporadas nos mitos americanos que, quer nos escritos de George Washington ou de Thomas Jefferson, quer no hip-hop contemporâneo. Seu livro mais recente, Yonder, lançado no Brasil pela editora Instante com o título Em Algum Lugar Lá Fora, insere-se numa rica tradição de ficção histórica centrada na vida de pessoas escravizadas, situando a sua experiência no contexto da história americana no século XIX. Atualmente, Jabari é professor no Emerson College, em Boston, e colabora para publicações como o jornal The New York Times, entre outros. Com vocês, Jabari Assim. Jabari, muito obrigada pela honra da conversa. O tema do nosso papo é Reimaginando a Escravidão na Literatura Americana. E aí eu preparei todas as perguntas, e aí eu estava ali fora ouvindo o Henry Louis Gates, e aí eu falei, meu Deus, eu vou ter que mudar a pauta toda, porque muitas coisas vieram de insight dali. Mas, pegando ali o fim da conversa do Henry Louis com a Jamaica Kincaid, ele fala sobre uma tradição, né, da literatura ou feita por pessoas que foram escravizadas e conseguiram fugir e contar suas histórias, ou também feita por pessoas que, de alguma maneira, vivenciaram ou tentam recriar esse período trágico da humanidade. Pensando no seu projeto literário, que a gente tem um. Eu falei que eu ia fazer o apelo para as editoras lançarem os outros livros do Jabari, aqui no Brasil são muitos. Né? Então, pensando nesse projeto literário que você tem de livros de ficção, não ficção, poesia, muitos livros infantis, como você acha que a sua obra, o seu projeto literário se insere, se é que ele se insere nessa tradição?
Sorry, the translation has got me a little bit. Could the question be repeated?
Ah, tá bom. Eu queria saber o seguinte, pensando no seu projeto literário de poesia, livros de ficção, não ficção, livros para criança, e linkando com o tema do nosso papo, que é reimaginando a escravidão na literatura americana, como você acha que esse projeto literário se insere dentro dessa tradição literária?
Oh, okay. I think I got it.
Acho que agora eu consegui entender. Obrigado.
My literary project,
então, meu projeto de literatura
envolve countering what I call,
contar o que eu chamo de
master narratives, which are
narrativas mestres,
stories that the,
ou histórias
that the people in power tell about people who are oppressed. So part of what I want to do is sort of counter those stories. And stories about black people in America have often been inaccurate. And so in poetry, children's books, fiction, all of those different areas, I'm writing to challenge those stories and to reveal what I hope will be illuminating truths about the reality of the black experience in the United States.
Ótimo. Como eu mencionei aqui, antes da tradução tá rolando, o Henry Louis Gates falou ali no final da conversa com a Jamaica Kincaid sobre essa tradição literária, né, que existe nos Estados Unidos de livros sobre esse período, sejam eles escritos por pessoas que foram escravizadas, depois tiveram a oportunidade de contar essas histórias, seja por autores que pesquisam ou ficcionalizam ou partem desse período para escrever seus livros. Queria que você me falasse um pouco sobre qual é a sua relação com essa tradição literária. Como foi o seu despertar para ela? Quem foram as pessoas que você primeiro leu?
I read very hungrily about this period. As you say, there are many narratives written by people who were enslaved in the United States. And I read as many as I could get my hands on. Some of the obvious ones are Booker T. Washington, Up From Slavery. Frederick Douglass wrote three narratives, three memoirs about his life. Those are very influential, not just to me, but to other writers who write about the period. So I spent a lot of time with those. I spent a lot of time just researching in general from historians, scholars, etc., who were writing about the period. And in particular, I was intrigued by a story about a man named William Lee, who was an enslaved black man who served George Washington. And he was in love with a free black woman named Margaret. And George Washington told him, at the end of the Revolutionary War, you will be able to bring this free black woman to the plantation, and she can live with you. But at the end of the war, George Washington went back on his promise. So I began to think, what would it feel like to serve this man in battle, to face dangers with him, to do so much work for him, all with the idea, not even that you would become free, but that you would be free to love, that you could be with this woman who loves you and you love her, and then be told that you can't. And that was the reality for most black people during that period in the United States. You could not choose who you love. You could not choose who you would be with, who would be your partner. It was, in fact, against the law for you to make that choice. So I wanted to explore that in fiction.
Existe, dentro dessa sua, esse seu desejo de explorar isso numa obra de ficção, existem algumas figuras específicas que você, ou eventos específicos desse período de escravidão, que você se dedicou mais a pesquisar?
I don't know if there was a particular period that attracted my attention. I should also say that William and Margaret's story, their story was actually 18th century. My story is in the 19th century, so I moved it forward. I didn't keep any of the details about those actual figures except their names, and the rest is imagined. And it also ties in with my interest in my own family history. In the United States, black people can only trace their history back so far because we weren't listed on the census. And we weren't listed on the census until 1870. And even then, we were not given names. So we would just be listed as one Negro man, two Negro women, etc., like that. And so my own family, we can only trace it back so far to a particular couple. Their names are Sam and Iris. They were children when slavery ended in the United States, and they married and began the family that ultimately led to me. So I was curious about, not just about them, but about the couples before them. Who were the people before Sam and Iris? Who made Sam and Iris? What were the circumstances like? Were these love relationships? Were they able to stay together? And so I began to imagine that. I tried to fill in the gaps in my own family history through a work of imagination.
Isso é maravilhoso, porque eu costumo dizer em conversas como essa que a gente está tendo aqui hoje, que é exatamente a mesma situação aqui no Brasil. Né? Se você é uma pessoa birracial, como eu, por exemplo, de uma vertente da família que é descendente de italiano, eu consigo fazer a árvore genealógica toda. Da vertente africana para na bisavó ou na trisavó. Né? É impossível, não existe documento, não existe registro. E eu acho muito bonito a gente poder dar um passado, né, criar um passado para aquelas pessoas que não tiveram a chance, né, não tem como reconstruir isso, né. Quando foi, que momento foi que você sentiu que você queria fazer, que a sua obra teria esse tipo de intenção também, porque a sua obra é extensa?
I don't know. I mean, that's a good question. I appreciate it. It's hard to think of this particular book outside of the other books that I'm writing or have written. It's all part of this larger project, right? I'm trying to project certain voices into the conversation that would otherwise be excluded. And like a lot of people who are descended from enslaved Africans, I'm both mesmerized and tortured by what I don't know. And so that curiosity kind of fuels a lot of my work as a writer and as a thinker and as a teacher. And that's sort of what propels me. At the same time, we have a photo of Sam and Iris. And I had it on my writing desk as I wrote the story, right? So that I could kind of commune with them and listen to them and combine that with the actual historical research to tell a story that I hoped would be compelling to people besides myself. You know, it was automatically an interesting story for me. But when you're writing a novel, you're writing it to be read. And you're also imagining readers on the other side of that transaction. And so you're working to tell this story with language, with characters, etc., that will hold their attention.
Falando especificamente agora, né, a gente está falando, na verdade, algum lugar lá fora, nos Estados Unidos, o título dele é Yonder, que significaria além. E aí, sem dar muitos spoilers, você poderia contar um pouquinho da sinopse principal do livro?
Sure. So the story takes place in 1852. On an unnamed, not an unnamed plantation, but on a plantation in an unnamed part of the American South. And it tells the story of two couples who are in love, but the circumstances are challenging because the man who owns them gets to decide who gets to be a couple and who doesn't. And certain developments happen in their lives where they're kind of faced with this question, do we continue to struggle under these circumstances or do we take a chance, risk our lives and try to escape? And so the question becomes, what are you willing to risk for love? And that is the question that these characters had to wrestle with.
Essa é a questão principal com a qual eles se defrontam. Uma das coisas fascinantes desse livro é que você faz ali um trabalho muito delicado de criar cada um dos personagens, dando a voz a eles, né? Você vai revezando ali o ponto de vista da história a cada um dos personagens. Por que você escolheu esse formato ali, esse jeito de contar a história em que cada personagem aparece contando, narrando ali, sob o seu ponto de vista, a trajetória do que eles dessa fuga?
I love that question. Originally, when I set out to write the novel, only one character was telling the story, and that was William. It was William's book. The other characters existed, but he was describing and narrating the events of their lives. But at some point, when I was writing, these other characters began to speak to me and say, well, you know, William isn't always correct. He has his point of view, but it's different from mine. We experienced these things together, but I saw them differently. I felt them differently. And this is how it happened from my point of view. So I decided to respect those voices, and it made it a much more challenging story to write. It's like, okay, now I've got to establish a distinct narrative voice for each of these characters, so one doesn't sound like the other. And at the same time, move the plot along toward its resolution. So, if it had been up to me, I wouldn't have used multiple narrators, but they insisted, and I decided to respect their wishes.
Maravilhoso. Tem um autor aqui no Brasil, que é o Itamar Vieira Júnior, que também é um homem negro, que é um grande vendedor de livros aqui no Brasil, romancista, e o livro mais recente dele também ia ser narrado por um único personagem, e aí ele fala que a outra personagem falou se impôs, né? E, de repente, ele perdeu o controle sobre ela. Você, e ela dominou a história, você, além disso tudo, é professor de literatura, de escrita criativa, enfim, né? Queria que você falasse um pouco desse relacionamento com personagens, esses personagens, de repente, se impõem, esses personagens que dominam as narrativas. Quem nessa narrativa foi... Eu acho que foi a Margaret, mas... que dominou, de repente, se impôs. E como é que você, quando você faz isso em sala de aula, como é que você trata essa criação de personagem com os seus alunos?
I tell my students they have to be respectful of the characters, right? I mean, you have to be flexible, you have to be willing to change the story if going in a different direction better serves the needs of the characters. That happened to a certain extent when writing Yonder. I had some ideas about where the story was going to go, and for the most part, that's how the story went. But in other instances, it went in directions I had anticipated because sort of listening to the characters, it went in other directions. So it becomes a question of how much does the reader need to stay with it? And I think the writer needs to know more than the reader, but isn't obligated to share all of that with the reader. Just share the parts of the information that move the story along and hold the reader's interest.
Gostaria que você falasse por que você escolheu o termo sequestrado para as pessoas escravizadas e ladrão para as pessoas brancas.
That's a great question, thank you. I never wanted to allow the reader to evade the central fact of the experience of these people is that they were very much involuntary immigrants. They came in chains, so it wasn't a matter of choice. They were stolen people. And I like to say that the United States exists on stolen land, enriched by the labor of stolen people. And so I wanted to use the language to insist on that framework, that the narrative take place in that context. And because we're telling the story from the point of view of the enslaved, They saw the people who held them in captivity as their captors, right? There's really not many ways, different ways you can look at that. So also, I'm kind of motivated by this idea that there's two languages, there's two tongues. There was a tongue that the black people used when it was just other black people, and another tongue that they used when in the presence of their oppressors, right? And so the language that they use with each other, they refer to their captors as thieves because it would be difficult for them to see them as anything else. I mean, they stole their children as soon as they were born. They sold them. They committed systematic and repeated atrocities and brutalities, which cannot be under-described, right? And so the reality of the period and the existence is that it was filled with horrors and it was unpredictable. And I wanted my language to reflect that.
Vocês poderão fazer perguntas no, na, depois da, na uma hora, da uma hora de conversa. Eu esqueci de dizer isso. Tem pessoas com papeizinhos que vão estão passando por aqui e vão trazer as perguntas para mim, tá bom? Voltando, Jabari. Tem uma... Você ali, eu queria entender um pouco do quanto tem de pesquisa histórica e o quanto você inseriu, porque tem alguns componentes ali fantásticos, né, que você usa da história também, que são muito bonitos, criam imagens muito bonitas. Eu fiquei imaginando um filme. Como é que você vai mesclando a fantasia? Até que ponto é a fantasia, até que ponto é a realidade, né, da sua pesquisa, e em que momentos você usa essa fantasia?
What is the right moment? I mean, it's difficult. I mean, part of it is instinctive, and part of it is I'm inside the imaginations of the characters. They're in a situation where they are essentially imprisoned. So it makes sense to me that their imagination would revolve around escape, transcendence, flight. And I knew from my research and from African-American folklore that a lot of that imagination revolved around a particular story about flying Africans, which was a common story among black captives in the United States during this period. There was this belief that some people had been enslaved, but they flew back to Africa because they were able to recite certain magic words that would enable them to take flight. This is a durable story that remains in African-American culture today. And so I wanted to kind of address that. I wanted to have a character be fascinated with this idea that he could fly away, that he could go back to Africa. At the same time, I wanted to put that up against the very limited knowledge that they were working with. Most of them had never been beyond the plantation. They didn't know where Africa was. They had heard that black people could be free in Canada. They didn't know where Canada was. But there were a lot of stories about flying to Canada or flying to Africa. So I wanted to kind of work those stories in. At the same time, I also have some fantasy elements that revolve around maroon, we call them maroon communities. In the United States, these were fugitive enslaved people who escaped, made homes in the woods, in the swamps, were never captured. And I wanted my characters to come in contact with those people as well. And because those people are almost, they're almost creatures of myth at this point, because we don't have much of a record of them, I was free to kind of make up things about them. Also, there were other things that are fully imagined. For example, the spiritual practices that my characters conduct are not actually based on research. I made them up entirely, right? So that's entirely made up. There's no historical record of it because it didn't exist. So, I mean, that's one of the things I like about fiction as opposed to my nonfiction, which is bound by the research. But with fiction, at some point, you're free to leave the research behind and imagine the rest of the story.
Você pode, às vezes, simplesmente deixar a parte histórica de lado.
E essa imagem, né, quando você estava falando agora, a gente aqui no Brasil tem a capoeira, né, que é aquela arte marcial, aquele jogo, aquela luta que era praticada pelos escravizados. E as pessoas, e literalmente, né, você pode voar em alguns golpes de capoeira. Então, realmente, é uma imagem muito bonita essa que você coloca no livro. Queria passar para um livro teu, que é aquele livro de ensaios, The N-Word, Who Can Say It, Who Shouldn't, and Why. E eu queria saber, você falou um pouco agora, né, você mencionou quando estava falando sobre o motivo pelo qual você escolheu usar ladrões e os sequestradores, né, os sequestrados e os ladrões, que tem a ver com a linguagem, né? Quanto essa pesquisa que você fez sobre linguagem se insere nessa sua escolha, né, nesse livro de ficção? E aí eu queria que você falasse um pouco sobre esse livro.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting you ask that because I'm really fascinated by language. So I try to address it in some way, whatever I'm writing. James Baldwin said, the root function of language is to control the universe by describing it. Richard Wright said that language was a battlefield between blacks and whites over the nature of reality, right? And so I'm interested with the N-word. I was interested in the extent to which language is weaponized against black people in the United States. And the N-word became a shorthand for subhuman. And one of the ways in which the language changed was that before the Civil War in the United States and emancipation, the word was basically used to quickly and easily describe the notion that black people were unfit for freedom. After the Civil War, when that argument was settled, at least temporarily, it became shorthand for black people are unfit for citizenship and all the rights and privileges it conveys, right? So I wanted to sort of trace the word from its earliest inceptions to the present day, but never looking at it as just a word, which is a common argument. Oh, it's only a word. Words can't hurt you. But I carefully tie the word to other developments in American culture, politics, violence, social interaction, education, the law, etc. You know, the idea that black people are unfit for full inclusion in society is attached to every aspect of governance and life in the United States. And so I wanted to look at that word as an opportunity to unpack all of that.
Você, eu infelizmente não li o livro, né? Vai sair aqui no Brasil, gente. A gente está fazendo uma forcinha aqui, agora forçando um pouco a barra. Mas em alguns textos que eu encontrei, né, na internet falando sobre ele, diz que você faz, né, você, como você mesmo mencionou aqui agora, essa pesquisa histórica, né? E que trata também ali da música contemporânea, em especial o hip hop. Queria que você falasse um pouco sobre como houve uma apropriação dessa palavra, o hip, né, como ela hoje, de alguma maneira, soa nessa cultura pop.
Well, first of all, I think with young people, you give them the history, you give them the facts, and then you get out of the way, right? And as a black person in the United States, the last thing I ever want from a writer is to tell me how to behave. But I want them to give me information that will encourage me to think critically. And so that was the goal. So it's not really a matter of you should do this, you should do that. I want to say, here's all the information between covers. Because when I was a young person, and young people use that word casually, the elders would say, you wouldn't use that word if you knew the history. If you knew the history, you wouldn't be saying that. But they seldom told us the history. So I wanted to capture that history, put it between covers, and say, here it is. You can settle this argument however you see fit. But my own personal position is, of all the language, of all the words available to you in English, available to black people, that word is the last word that you would want to own. And it is impossible for you to reclaim it because you never possessed it. And that's sort of what I'm saying in the book. Among the earliest usages that I found was the first 20 captive Africans arrived in the United States in 1619. The ledger book says, 20 niggers arrived today via a Dutch man of war. That is the earliest usage of the word. So almost from the very beginning, there's this argument, an attempt to establish this argument that these individuals we're bringing in are not like us. They're not human beings, right? They don't think, they don't feel, they don't love. So we can brutalize them as we see fit, right? And so for me, it's impossible to separate that idea, that horrible, heinous, venomous, rotten idea from the word.
Maravilhoso. Eu queria que você falasse um pouco sobre os ensaios que estão reunidos em We Can't Breathe.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so We Can't Breathe was, it was being composed during a period in the United States when police brutality, which has never ceased, but was sort of at a new peak. There were just a number of instances in which unarmed black people were killed by police. And so I began to write essays sort of responding to that idea and trying to make arguments and observations that suggest that the laws and the society and the expectations are rooted in dishonesty and continue to be. So the master narrative that I talk about, in most of those instances, that's the police report. The police report says the suspect resisted arrest. The suspect tried to take my gun. The suspect ran when we ordered him to stop. Video surveillance makes it clear that in the overwhelming majority of such instances, the police narrative is a falsehood. It is a lie. There are no facts to support those assertions. And what I want to encourage people to do is to not only regard those police reports with a healthy degree of skepticism, but to lean on the other side and say they are probably untrue because historically they have been untrue. They continue to be untrue in incident after incident. At the same time, private citizens began to feel empowered to shoot black people because they felt threatened. So they have castle laws in the United States, also known as stand your ground laws. So if you're a homeowner and a black person walks past your sidewalk, you can legally shoot them in states like Florida. You can make the argument that you were standing your ground. You felt threatened, and you were standing your ground, and you can shoot them, right? Most notoriously in Florida, but in a number of states in the United States. To me, this is crazy. And as a writer, I kind of feel an obligation to call these things out, expose them and condemn them.
É, bom, como você pode imaginar, aqui no Brasil a gente vive uma realidade exatamente igual. Esta semana, inclusive, nesta semana aqui que nós estamos, quatro jovens de 13, 14 anos estavam no Rio de Janeiro de férias, filhos de diplomatas de países africanos, cujos pais moram em Brasília, e eles foram parados pela polícia do Rio de Janeiro e que colocou a arma na cabeça deles. Enfim, como são tratados todos os jovens adolescentes do Brasil, é que, dessa vez, como eles são filhos de diplomatas, a coisa repercutiu. E aí, né, enfim, são aquelas histórias que a gente acompanha, né? Essa é a regra de como as pessoas negras, né, os jovens negros, em especial meninos negros, são tratados aqui no Brasil, o homem negro, né? Um país que vive o genocídio da juventude negra. E aí a gente fica muito, né, a gente, na literatura, no domingo, a Camila Sousa Fijada, falando sobre a perspectiva das travestis, das pessoas trans, ela falou, no fim das contas, a literatura não serve para nada, porque não vai salvar a vida dessas pessoas. Né? Como é que você se sente? Porque é isso. É escrever as histórias e continuar a ser o testemunha dessas histórias diariamente.
Yeah, I don't think literature can save the lives of people. But I think if it is your particular calling to tell stories, then you should aim those stories in the direction of justice, right? I'm at peace with the idea that as a writer, I can't stop police brutality, I can't stop racial injustice, but I can continue to call it out. I think that's what I'm supposed to do, right? So I'm comfortable doing that. I will add that I went on a two and a half hour walk through Sao Paulo, and every time a policeman was near, I was aware of that policeman in the same way that I am in the United States. I have a strong aversion to police. My personal experiences with police are bad, and police in the United States are henchmen of the state. So when someone like me sees a policeman, doesn't matter what color they are, they have that gun on their hip, my blood pressure rises. It is unavoidable, and it's generational. It was my grandfather's experience. It was my father's experience. It was my brother's experience. I have four sons. It is their experience as well. So I was kind of struck by that.
Lamentamos muito, Jabbar, mas, infelizmente, é esta mesmo a realidade. Voltando ao tema, né, da nossa conversa e falando sobre essa tradição da literatura sobre o período da escravidão, o Henry Louis Gates mencionou que existiam 105 livros que foram escritos por pessoas que foram escravizadas e depois escreveram sobre esse período. Tem uma coisa que eu acho que hoje que é interessante, que são essas muitas perspectivas sobre esse período. Então, o seu livro traz ali uma coisa do fantástico. Aí existem pessoas como, por exemplo, o Robert Jones Jr., com o livro Os Profetas, que faz um recorte, né, de gênero, contando ali a história de dois jovens negros gays durante esse período da escravidão. Como professor, imagino que você deve acompanhar muito essa cena de jovens autores trazendo novas perspectivas para esse período. Quais são as mais interessantes? O que você tem visto com relação a isso?
One of the, I guess, maybe not when my book came out, I think it was when the movie 12 Years a Slave came out. A prominent rapper in the United States said, black people shouldn't make any more of these movies. There have been similar comments about books. We don't need to tell this story. To me, that's insane. When we think of the thousands of Africans who were enslaved, the Africans who drowned in the Atlantic during the Middle Passage, the Africans who turned around and went back in the water and drowned themselves rather than be enslaved, the Africans that were thrown off of slave ships and fed to the sharks in exchange for insurance payments, each of those individuals has a story attached to them. I think we have an obligation to reclaim every single one of those stories. And until we do that, we have to continue to tell the stories of that period. If we don't, the people who did the enslaving will tell the story. And their story is incorrect, and it's inaccurate, and it must be fought on all levels at all times. I think we've only scratched the surface of stories about that period. And I agree with Dr. Gates that the stories that have been collected, the narratives, are so invaluable. They are a source of valuable information for fiction writers like myself. For example, the stories about Harriet Tubman in the United States, the amazing things that she did, they sound like fantasy stories. They're hard to believe. Story after story, they're all true. She actually did those things. So I tried to imagine a character inspired by Harriet Tubman in the book called Swing Low, who is a superhero, basically. Because to me, Harriet Tubman was a real-life superhero, and others were as well. And I wanted to include that element in the novel.
Muito bacana. Eu acho que também tem uma outra perspectiva interessante sobre esse, a literatura, né, a ficção feita sobre esse período, que é a dos jovens filhos de africanos que ou migraram para a América ou nasceram para a América. Então, vou pegar um exemplo, a escritora Yaa Gyasi, que é, né, ela tem um livro... Nos Estados Unidos ele chama-se Homecoming, aqui no Brasil De Volta para Casa, que é a perspectiva, né, o livro dela ali é uma saga de duas pessoas escravizadas, mas contada da perspectiva de uma jovem, né, a autora é uma jovem romancista que nasceu na África, migrou para os Estados Unidos e vive nos Estados Unidos e tem o contato com essa história de uma outra maneira. Ou então por jovens que ainda foram estudar em países do Ocidente e voltaram para a África e lá são romantistas, escrevem, são ficcionistas e contam essa história sobre outras perspectivas. Queria saber o que de interessante você tem visto nessas, porque de uma certa maneira cria uma conversa, né, de pontos de vista.
Yes, like I say, there's room for so many more of those stories. And I think writing about the experiences of children who are enslaved, my first book was a novel for middle schoolers, and it's about a little boy who's enslaved. And the story begins right at emancipation, like on the day he finds out that he's emancipated. And I think the stories about children being enslaved are fascinating. There's so many more. The ones that intrigue me the most are the ones about romance, right? Because Thomas Jefferson was the authority on African American behavior. He wrote a book called Notes on the State of Virginia, which was, up till the Civil War, the most influential book in the United States about the science of African American behavior. And he wrote that black people don't feel physical pain like white people do. So you can whip them, you can torture them. George Washington's favorite method of disciplining his slaves was pickling them, which takes place in the novel. But Thomas Jefferson also wrote that black people were incapable of genuine loving relationships, that we were moved by animal desires. And you know, this was written by a man who kept an enslaved black woman in a little room, and you know, she was 14, he was 41. Right, and he had sex with her regularly. At the same time, he's writing that black people are motivated by pure animal instinct. Genuine romantic attachments are beyond them. So I wanted in the book to focus on genuine romantic attachments. What does it mean to be in love in these circumstances? And I should add that of the many novels about slavery during this period, the one that I like the most is called The Known World by Edward P. Jones. And he has a page in there where there's this enslaved man. He's in love with this enslaved woman. He wants to approach her. He has nothing to give her, absolutely nothing. So he takes a piece of wood and he carves a comb, you know, a hair comb, and he gives it to her. And he says, I know it's not much. And she says, it be the whole world. And that when I read that passage, I put the book down, I closed it, and I walked away because it moved me so much, right? And so that's where I got the idea, okay, you have nothing to give this other person except yourself, right? What are the circumstances surrounding that? How does that take place? How do we demonstrate our love? How do we secure it, right? You say you love this person says, guess what, I love you back. It's not that simple, right? There's so much more going on because of these enslaved people were bred like livestock, right? And that was part of the reality. So if you're being considered an animal and held as an animal, but you have these very human feelings, what do you do with that? And that's what I wanted to explore.
Você mencionou, né, o seu livro para adolescentes, mas eu queria que você agora contasse sobre a sua obra para crianças, que é vasta. E quais são as temáticas que você trata nela? E por que que você começou a escrever para crianças, especialmente?
Well, I started writing for children because my wife and I have 5 children. We wanted to entertain them. We're a book-loving house, and so we wanted them to have some books in which the characters look like they look, and they look like me, right? So so I wanted to create stories for them, and interestingly, my best-selling book is a book for babies, for children who can't read. It's to be read to them. And it's full of silly rhymes, and it's called Whose Toes Are Those, right? And it has a companion book that's called Whose Knees Are These, right? And so they came from nonsense rhymes that I would tell my children to entertain them. You know, I made up rhymes to get them to do things, right? Tie your shoes, pick up your clothes, brush your teeth, put on your pajamas, take a bath, whatever. And I would always make up rhymes. And then before they would go to sleep, I would have to tell each child a secret, right? I made up a secret for each child, right? They wouldn't go to bed without hearing their secret. So one day I was doing one of those, and my wife said, I think that's a book. You should write that down. So I wrote it down. It sold. It continues to sell. And that's how I got started writing children's books.
Muito bom, maravilhoso. Você, antes da gente vir para cá, a gente estava falando ali sobre, né, a sua carreira como jornalista. Você trabalhou no Washington Post, você editou por mais de uma década a revista Crisis, que é uma revista da NAACP, que é a mais importante organização dedicada aos direitos humanos dos Estados Unidos. Hoje, ali fazendo, né, lendo sobre você, eu vi vários textos seus assinados por, né, no New York Times. Qual é a responsabilidade do jornalismo em... também não vai fazer a revolução, mas qual a responsabilidade do jornalismo nessas questões raciais contemporâneas?
I think the role of journalists is increasingly imperiled. There's so much artificial media. There's so many self-appointed experts who just get on Twitter and say things that are not rooted in fact, research, or interviews. So journalists are more important than ever. And you know what I've tried to do in the United States, there's this saying, journalists want to or should want to afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. And so that's one of the principles that motivates me. Also, as a student of history, I know that the first black newspaper in the United States was called Freedom's Journal. And on the top of every issue, it said, we wish to plead our own cause. And that's part of what I think, at least what I hope to do whenever I sit down to do journalism. That's kind of motivated me throughout my career.
Muito bom. Tem perguntas? Só para saber que a gente está chegando na uma hora.
That was fast.
Muito rápido. Muito boa. É uma pergunta que tinha até a ver aqui com uma pergunta, vou juntar com a minha. Quanto do que você coloca na história que se passa em 1852 pode ser identificado na América contemporânea. E aí eu ia perguntar justamente isso. Como é que você vê o legado da escravidão moldando culturalmente e socialmente a sociedade contemporânea?
How do I see the legacy of slavery changing society? Well, the United States racial progress has not occurred because people's hearts have changed. It has occurred because laws have changed. So, if civil rights laws had not been passed during the 1960s, I believe the United States would still be a society segregated by law. It remains a society segregated by custom, right? So that hasn't necessarily changed. The other thing that's different is we had a sympathetic Supreme Court during the 1960s. We have the opposite now in the United States. So we find that slavery, I guess what complicates it is people like me are the descendants of the enslaved. We are still in uneasy coexistence with people who are the descendants of the enslavers. And we've never reconciled that, right? There's still this delusional white supremacy in the United States, which suggests that black people are beneath the benefits conferred to regular citizens. And it's an undesirable legacy of the era of enslavement, but it's very durable. And it went underground during the 8 years of the Obama presidency. It became impolite to say racist comments in public or to endorse them. But in the era of Trump, it's above ground. White people can be openly racist once again with few consequences. That also is a legacy of the era of enslavement. So I think the most important thing for people who are opposed to injustice is resistance. We resisted then. It's important to note that we had allies, that the advances that we have achieved could not have been achieved without the assistance of a tiny minority of very brave white people. And they still exist, and they are still a tiny minority, right? So, and that's who we work with in the battle for complete justice, which has never been realized. The 13th Amendment ended slavery except for in the instance of criminal activity. So it is legal to enslave a convicted criminal. And the prison system in the United States is overwhelmingly black. And they perform forced labor on behalf of the states. So in a certain way, in a certain aspect, slavery has never ended.
Pensando na tenebrosa perspectiva do Trump se tornar presidente dos Estados Unidos de novo, o que, que é que os afro-americanos estão, de alguma maneira, projetando para o resultado dessa eleição?
I think many of us, we kind of waver between anger and despair, right? It seems naive to experiment with optimism at this period in the United States. Trump has already promised to expand the powers of the president in a dictatorial direction. And the Supreme Court has supported that. So it's not a time for optimism.
Você acha que os principais escritores negros ou brancos são fiéis ao tratar das dores do racismo?
I think there are a number of writers in the States who write about race and racism with candor and authority and honesty and passionate feelings deeply rooted in research and facts. I think that the writing community, not to generalize too much about it, but there's a healthy percentage of progressive-leaning thinkers in that community, and they're doing work in that direction. They are calling for resistance. They are exposing injustice.
Essa pergunta que eu acabei de fazer é do Maurício Machado, que mandou mais uma, e aí ele fez a seguinte pergunta. O que o diferencia dos escritores negros americanos a narrar a questão racial no país?
It doesn't set me apart because there are so many of us making these arguments, and I mean, more than I could name, but it's a long list of black writers who are doing that work, and I'm glad to be counted a member of that community.
Se você tivesse aqui, né, eu imagino que você deve estudar isso com seus alunos, né? Quem são os autores, os jovens autores negros que estão tratando, seja lá de qual for o tema, que você considera hoje expoentes da literatura norte-americana?
One writer, I have trouble coming up with lists on the spot, but one writer who immediately comes to mind is Wesley Lowery. He's done a couple of really good books on the racial scene in the United States. He has a new one out now. I can't think of the title. He used to be a reporter at the Washington Post. He's very young. He's doing good work. He's not so young anymore, but Jelani Cobb at the New Yorker does really good work. And Ta-Nehisi Coates at the Atlantic. When I was an editor at the Washington Post, I recruited a couple of young writers who were very young at the time to write for the Washington Post. They were Jelani Cobb and Ta-Nehisi Coates. And Jelani Cobb is now the dean of the Columbia School of Journalism in New York. He's a reliable reporter on race and justice in the New Yorker.
Tem uma pergunta aqui sobre se você pensou em adaptar seu livro para o cinema. E aí eu queria juntar com isso esse momento que a gente vive, em especial por conta de séries, que tem uma efervescência ali de uma criação de jovens diretores negros, atores negros, né? Então, eu vou pegar o exemplo da Issa Rae, por exemplo. A Issa Rae, né, que é roteirista, é diretora, é atriz, mas não só ela, né? Então, pensando, né, nisso, dos seus livros, esse livro é muito cinematográfico. Eu queria que você falasse um pouco se existe alguma intenção e também que você falasse um pouco sobre essa cena de jovens negros africanos afro-americanos no audiovisual.
This does seem to be the biggest generation of African American screenwriters ever. Cord Jefferson, who used to be a young journalist, is now a screenwriter. He adapted American Fiction. He won an Academy Award for it, an Oscar. You mentioned Issa Rae. There's a woman named Ava DuVernay who has done really good work. There's so many. So yes, I have given that thought. I would like that very much. The filmmaking industry is sort of beyond my expertise, but the book is represented by an agency that specializes in getting books turned into movies. We haven't had an offer for it yet, but I remain hopeful.
Você mencionou American Fiction. Eu assisti umas três vezes o American Fiction. Berrava em casa assistindo o filme. A gente vive aqui no Brasil hoje, eu não sei como é que o mercado editorial se comporta nesse sentido nos Estados Unidos, mas aqui no Brasil, os principais vendedores de livros são mulheres e pessoas negras. Então, a gente tem o maior vendedor de livros de romance, é o Itamar Vieira Júnior, a maior vendedora de livro, é uma autora que é uma mulher branca, mas é uma mulher, o que já é muito importante, que se chama Carla Madeira. Aí a gente tem a Djamila Ribeiro, que é uma filósofa, uma mulher negra, que tem uma obra, inclusive, traduzida já em várias línguas e é muito importante. Você chega nas livrarias hoje, em algumas, a primeira pilha que tem na frente é de livros de mulheres, e muitas mulheres negras, muitos livros de mulheres negras, como Bell Hooks, Angela Davis, Maya Angelou, todas sendo lançados aqui, e também uma busca por jovens autores negros. Todo mundo, toda casa de, toda editora quer ter o novo Itamar Vieira Júnior, quer ter a nova Djamila Ribeiro. Então, tem vê-se ali um investimento nas feiras, tem escritores negros. Há um tempo atrás isso não era uma realidade. E aí, eu queria que você falasse um pouco como é que é esse cenário nos Estados Unidos. E eu imagino também, porque ali no American Fiction, a gente fica... porque existe... enfim, todo tipo de literatura sendo feita, mas eu fico imaginando que deve ter também ali alguns estereótipos, né, que são criados de precisar escrever de tal e tal maneira, que o filme apresenta brilhantemente.
Well, you know, as a journalist, I covered the publishing industry for over 20 years. I've never been optimistic about it. I acknowledged that I'm among the privileged few who is able to get published on a regular basis. But the reality is, there's so many talented writers, black, white, male, female, non-binary, who are not getting published, right? And it's a combination of circumstances, right? It's money, and also it's a lack of representation within publishing houses of people with those backgrounds who will identify these manuscripts as something worth publishing. In recent years, black women have been named to head major publishing houses in the United States, including Simon & Schuster. But in recent weeks, those women have lost their jobs, right? And 20 years ago, the publishers started about 6 imprints devoted to African-American literature. I think one of them still exists at this point. So every once in a while, there's like an eruption of work by marginalized or underrepresented communities. And then it goes away. So I'm beginning to see signs that it's going away again by the departure of, I think, three black women I can name who headed publishing houses in the United States who, as of today, don't have their jobs.
E aí, como professor, como é que você lida com esse cenário com os seus alunos?
I tell them the reality of it. That there's no guarantee that they will be published. They still have an obligation. If this is their calling, you have to obey your calling. I mean, that's what I did. You know, I didn't think, I wasn't confident that I would be published or that anyone would like my work, but I felt consumed by this impulse to write. And it was so powerful, I thought I should pay attention to it, that I should take it seriously. So I tell my students, I didn't choose writing, writing chose me. And if writing chose you, you've got to do it, regardless of the odds. You have to do this work. And I tell them it's utterly unpredictable, right? We've had students who have published, done really well in the world, and we've kind of said, you know, as colleagues, wow, that's not the student that we guessed was about to be a star, right? And then there are other students who are like, oh, she's a genius. But 10 years later, she's still waiting to be published, right? So there's no science to it, right? But if it's the thing that you're supposed to do, you have to do it.
E numa das entrevistas que eu li que você deu para uma revista estadunidense, você fala que você, a jornalista falava que você compartilhava o seu processo de criação de alguns livros seus, ou não sei se foi de um especificamente, com os seus alunos. Queria que você contasse um pouco dessa experiência.
Sure. I share every aspect of my publishing journey with my students. I show them manuscripts that failed, that were rejected by everybody, that no one ever bought or published. I show them. I show them editors' comments. Like for Yonder, when it was being edited and I was going back and forth with the editor, I would bring in pages and show the editor's comments. I would tell the students, this is what we're discussing about this passage. I always do that because I want them to know that even for writers whom they see as overwhelming successes, there's this underside of it. Because I'm very prolific. I write a lot. Everything I write does not become a book, right? So I take them through that process because I want them to understand the whole process. It's not just romance and whimsy. I had an idea, I wrote it down, and now it's in the bookstore. You know, there's back and forth, there's exchanges, there's arguments, there's discussions with marketing people, et cetera. With the end goal, you hope that your book will be on the shelf, that it will find readers. And so, yeah, I take them as intimately through that process as I can for every book.
No que você está trabalhando agora?
My next book is a children's book. It's a picture book. It's about the mural movement in the United States during the 1960s. There was a mural painted in Chicago. It was called The Wall of Respect. It had black heroes on it. It became famous. So other cities began to do the same thing, Detroit, St. Louis, etc. And the wall in St. Louis was made by a collective of 7 visual artists. That's where I was growing up. So 2 of the artists lived in my house, my father and my brother. And it became a very famous focal point of civil rights activity in St. Louis. So I revisited that in this picture book. I fictionalized the story somewhat. I create a little boy who helps his father work on this mural. That will come out sometime in 2025. My next book for adults is nonfiction, and it's an appreciation of Marvin Gaye, Sam Cooke, and Donny Hathaway, 3 black musical giants in the United States.
Eu acho que ele falou o nome dos... O livro vai ser sobre Marvin Gaye e os outros dois são quem?
Oh, Sam Cooke and Donny Hathaway.
Ok. Aproveitando que você falou isso, então, tinha uma pergunta assim aqui que era qual o papel do jazz, né? Então, já com esse spoiler que você deu do próximo livro, a gente já entende que você tem um interesse, né? Então, queria que você contasse um pouco como é que é esse seu relacionamento com né, o jazz, especialmente.
That's a great question. I love old school R&B, and I really love jazz. So my last book for children is called A Child's Introduction to Jazz. So it's sort of a small encyclopedia that traces the jazz tradition from its earliest days in Congo Square in New Orleans up to the present. I'm usually listening to jazz when I'm writing. Yeah, I absolutely love it. So when I was in college, everyone in my social group was into hip hop. But I was president of the Jazz Society. I brought Count Basie to campus, and he was like 100 years old. My friends were like, who is this old guy? And I was like, that's Count Basie. So I love jazz.
Maravilhoso. Jabari, numa coletânea de ensaios, você escreveu: num determinado dia, com que frequência consigo manter o pensamento opressivo fora da minha cabeça? Estarei alguma vez livre de um imaginário olhar branco? Você acha que, com a literatura, você conseguiu, de alguma maneira, criar um espaço em que você consegue se livrar desse olhar branco de...
I think that Yeah, literature provides a refuge from the realities of the world, both as a reader and as a writer. I feel somewhat impervious to violation when I'm in my creative space, when I'm doing that work. So it's both a means of expression and a coping strategy.
Tibara, eu queria agradecer muitíssimo pela conversa. Muito obrigada. Em algum momento, a gente precisa acabar, não é mesmo, gente? Segunda-feira tem mais na Bíblia e o Jabari Yassin vai autografar agora aqui no estande da Dois Pontos. Leiam em algum lugar lá fora e daqui a pouco vai ter mais livros dele aqui, que a gente já combinou. Tá bom? Muito obrigada, Jabari.
Obrigado.